Good morning. Good morning. It's great to see you all here this morning and to be able to continue in worship as we dig into God's Word. Coming to this, the end of this series on dealing with pain, I was taking all of my weeks of study and trying to bring it all down into this last sermon. And of course, middle of the week, we were looking at about an hour and a half of sharing here this morning. So I started cutting. And then when I sat down here this morning, I opened up my notes and I'm looking at my introduction, and it just has four words. And I guess I deleted the rest, but forgot to add it back in. But as I was sitting there and I was praying and I was thinking about these four words, it's the best intro ever. Because it says, this morning, I am. And I was sitting there thinking, what was I supposed to write in there? I can't remember what I was supposed to write. But this morning, I am. I pray that this morning, the great I am, the God Almighty, who calls himself I am, would speak to your heart, would take from my words and through his Holy Spirit interpret into your heart his message, his love, his grace, that you would see and hear from Almighty God this morning, not from Pastor Byron, but from the I am. 4 weeks ago, I asked that you would send me thoughts or experiences that you've had when you've dealt with pain, when you've addressed pain, when you've had pain in your heart or in your life. And one of the ones that I got early on in this series was this. And it says, I personally think that the lesson to be learned here is for all of us to think before we speak. And then she included an acronym for the word think, and that is to say for T, the things that are true. For H, ask ourselves, is it helpful what we're going to say? I, is it inspiring? Is it going to build up or is it going to tear down? N, is it necessary? Because often we say things that aren't necessary, even though they do fit into the rest of the category. And the last is it kind? And I think if we have to say it, if what we have to say is not those things, then perhaps it should not be said at all. And then she included in here the worst story that she had heard. It was of a lady whose husband had died at a young age of a heart attack. And someone in her church told her that there must be sin in his life for God to pour out this kind of punishment or judgment onto him. As evangelicals, as Christians, as followers of Christ, I want you to think before we speak. We need to think before we speak. And we can all say things that we don't mean, but we can do a lot of harm if we don't have wisdom in what we say. So as I've come through this series, this topic of pain has raised a lot of questions. Pain does raise a lot of questions, and we've addressed some of those questions over this last few weeks. There are certain things that we may never see as a gift from God. And granted, all pain may not be a gift from God. So how do I move forward when the earthquake of pain shatters my world? Because pain can destroy us if we allow it to. If we get stuck focusing on our pain or the cause of our pain, we can live out the rest of our lives destroyed by the pain that has happened to us. And so this morning I would like to focus on a passage in Matthew. And the title that comes before it in my Bible is We Building Our Lives on a Solid Foundation. So what if we build our lives as followers of Christ, as seekers of the Almighty, on a solid foundation? So it's Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27. And many of you have heard this story. It's a Sunday school story. It's a story that's been preached on many times. And I'm going to try and share from it and pray that the I Am will speak to your heart this morning. Anyone who listens to my teachings and follows it is wise. Like a person who builds a house upon a solid rock, though the rains come in torrents and floodwaters rise and the winds beat against the house, it won't collapse because it is built on bedrock. But anyone who hears my teaching and doesn't obey it is foolish. Like a person who builds a house on sand. When the rains and floods come, notice here is not if the rains and floods come, it's when the rains and floods come, and the wind beats against that house, it will collapse with a mighty crash. As we look at this passage, anyone who listens to the teachings of Christ and follows them, lives them out, is like a wise person building their house upon a solid rock. What if we listened and applied the teachings of Scripture to our lives? What if you actually took what we read, took what you heard on a Sunday, and actually started to apply those teachings to our lives? You know, your faith, your house, your eternal security would not collapse when the calamities of pain and hardships and struggles of this life come, if we built our foundation on the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to the admonition of verse 26. Anyone who hears my teaching and does not obey it is foolish. Like a person who builds a house on sand. There is a need for us as followers of Christ to have a strong, spiritually stable foundation, one that will last through the storms of this life and into eternity. And that foundation is found in God's Word. One of my biggest struggles in studying God's Word is to dig in and to find the context. I think for any of us, when we're studying God's Word, we need to look at the context. And we like to take stories like this, and we like to set them up and go, this is a really cool story, and we focus on it, but then we don't look around it. And I like to look for what it is that is around a passage. And so I started looking, and another passage that I have spoken on and have looked at many times was there, and I hadn't made that connection between them, because at the beginning of this section, starting at 24, there's a little title break. And in that title break, it's building on the firm foundation. And so from that little title break, I sort of look, well, that's the start of this passage. But in the original, it wasn't until a few hundred years back that we actually took and put in all these breaks and all these titles and everything like that. And so I feel like we missed a little bit of the context of this passage. Because if we look back at Matthew 7, verse 21, it says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and performed many miracles in your name. But I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's law. Anyone who listens to my teachings and follows it is like a wise person who builds their house upon a rock. And as I read that, and I thought, you know, it is so amazing that we are called not just to acknowledge who God is. We are called not just to serve Him, but we are called into acknowledgement and obedience to His teaching. And if we do that, we are called wise. What if I claim, Lord, Lord, and I came to church and God said, depart from me. None of this church, Bible, singing, doing right means anything if we're not willing to follow the instructions that God has laid out in His Word for us. If we're not willing to live out the teachings of Scripture, then how can we expect God to accept that we have the faith that He is offering us? We often miss this picture of God turning people away due to their lack of obedience because of that break in our Bible, that little title that sticks out there. And that's where we start reading and don't read around it. And so I want to encourage you, when you read Scripture, when you look at God's Word, that you take it in context, that you look all around it, and you discover the true message that God is trying to speak into the life of the believer. You know, Satan will use pain in our lives to attempt to draw us away from God. When we are in pain of loss or divorce or loneliness or injury, we often lash out at God. Look at the story of Job. Satan used all sorts of calamities through the loss of wealth, through the loss of his home, through the loss of his family, and even the loss of his friends. And he used it all to try and get Job to come to the point where he would curse God. Like Job's great wife's advice, that why don't you just curse God and die? And Satan wants to use the pain in our lives to bring us to the point where we turn our back on God. Satan wants us to get to that point so that we will use the pleasures of this world. He will use the pleasures of this world to tempt us, to try and draw us away from God, so that when you're in pain, maybe if you go seek after alcohol or drugs, or maybe if you're in pain and you seek after, maybe you're in the pain of loneliness and you seek after comfort outside of the bounds of marriage, or maybe if you dig into the things that this world has to offer, maybe we'll find the comfort from our pain. And Satan wants to draw us and attract us with that, to draw us away from seeking after a firm foundation with God. And so, what if when I hurt, I don't look to sin to save me, but instead I look to a Savior to save me? The word sin, I learned this week, and after 20 years of being a pastor, it's kind of neat to keep discovering new things as you study. But I heard this week that the word sin is actually an old archery term. Now, maybe you guys knew this, and that's awesome, but the word sin is an archery word, and it was used when a person was practicing his or her shooting skills with a bow and arrow. And you would shoot at a target way down across the field, and instead of walking down to see if you missed the target, you would have a trusting soul standing down there beside the target. And he would look at your shot and where it hit, and then he would yell, if you missed, he would yell, sin! And what it meant is you missed the mark. And sin is a description of missing the mark that God has intended for us on how we're to live. And so living outside of what God's intention is for us in our lives, what He designed us for, doing anything else, we have that trusted soul at the target going, sin, you missed the mark. And when we live a life of missing the mark, we build our homes on sand and weak theology. So this morning I want to plead with you to build your house on a firm foundation, and that when the storms that will come and the pains that will happen in our lives, you can come and you can stand strong with the help of Almighty God there to hold you up and to carry you through. So what if I, as a follower of Christ, actually obeyed God? A firm foundation starts with the understanding of who God is. And I will not be able to share this morning all of who God is, but I want you to think about who God is. God is a person. He is a personal God. He is a relational God. He has relationship within the Godhead, and he desires to have relationship with you. God is creator. He is all-powerful. God is present everywhere at the same time. God knows everything. God is sovereign. God is a just judge. He is holy and righteous. God is absolute truth. God is love. He is merciful. He is faithful. But he is a jealous God. And my God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So when I look at the Old Testament and I see what I think is a different God from what I see in the New Testament, I have to look at them and go, how is God the same yesterday, today, and forever? How can I understand his character? Because he is unfathomable. He is uncontainable. He is unprecedented. He supplies strength to the weak. He is available to the tempted and tried. He comforts and sustains those who are in pain and who are sick or in weakness. He forgives the sinner and sets the captive free. He is a God that we will truly never completely understand on this side of eternity, because if he was a God that I could describe to you, he would be a puny God. But I don't worship a puny God. I don't worship a small God. I worship a God who's indescribable in his love and in his mercy and in his grace. God is faithful, and he is building your character to prepare you for your calling, which is to serve him, to give praise to him, to share his love with others, to love him and to be authentically compelled by God's love to go and make a difference in this world for Almighty God. As I said earlier, Satan will use pain to draw us away from God. But God can use pain to draw us closer to himself. I have this picture of a father holding his hurting child, and that is what God does for us. That is my favorite idea, a picture in my mind of when I fall, when I skin my knee or break my arm or have pain, my God, my Father comforts me. He strengthens me. He draws near to me in my sickness. He draws near to me in my pain. And when he does that, he gives me the strength to stand and to keep and to withstand the storms of this life. And so when the storms of this life come, we need to remember to let God define our circumstances, not our circumstances define our God. To have a firm understanding of a strong foundation of who God is, we need to study God's Word. I want to encourage you to get into a small group, into a Bible study, even if it's just one or two people that are getting in and discovering what God's Word says about who He is. Study His Word, study His character, because that is how we're going to see what His standards are and what His will is for us within our lives. And then if we start living out our lives through what we study, we discover that we will have strength from the all-powerful one to get us through. So what if, when tough times come, we understand the character of who God is? Then we won't buy into Satan's lies when the pain hits in our lives and seek after the sin of this life and miss the mark that God has designed for us. Pain can destroy. So we need to build a strong foundation, and a firm foundation needs to be a foundation of Christ-likeness, of actually allowing God's Word to transform our lives into Christ-likeness. What if we actually took seriously that old question that we used to put onto bracelets and wear? It was that WWJD. What would Jesus do? Someone after the first service said, Jesus used to wear that too. It was WWID. What would I do? But what if we actually lived it out? And when we came into circumstances and situations and we were wondering, is this Satan tempting me? Or if I actually asked myself, what would Jesus do in this circumstance, in this situation? Because if I am truly seeking to be Christ-like in my life, I would want to do what Jesus would do in this circumstance. So often we say it, but my challenge to us this morning is starting to live it, living that WWJD. Paul explained to the Thessalonians that in the end times, we need to be vigilant and watching and staying strong. And I would encourage you, if you have some time today, to take 1 Thessalonians 5 and read it. I wanted to read it, but that was part of the stuff that I had to take out so that we weren't here for all afternoon. But 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 in verse 14 and following, I'm just going to read a little bit of it. It says, brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those who are lazy. Encourage those who are timid. Take tender care of those who are weak. Be patient with everyone. See that no one pays back evil for evil, but always try to do good to each other and to all people. Always be joyful. Never stop praying. Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. In building our firm foundation, I want us to ask, what if we as a people of God actually loved other people like we love ourselves? If we did good to other people, if we encouraged other people, if we were patient with everyone, if we didn't repay evil for evil, but instead we did good to each other, to all people. What would it look like in our community if we were people like that? And then we seem to have some impossible statements here. They're impossible in our own strength, but we know that we are not living out our Christian life. We're not following God in our own strength. So what if we took seriously, always be joyful? Be joyful in every circumstance. How can we do that? Because bad things happen. We've already talked about that over this last few weeks. Bad things do happen, and struggles will come, and pains will come. So how can we be joyful in all circumstances? Well, joy is not based on circumstances. Joy is based on keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Joy is, like we talked about last week, joy, Christ with joy endured the cross. It was because he was looking forward to what was going to happen after this life. He was looking forward to the relationship that he was going to share with his creation. He was looking forward to the joy set before him. And because of that, he could endure the pain that he had to go through here on this earth. You know, I'm going to use an example of an upcoming trip that I have that we're planning as a family. And for me, it is extremely joyful to look ahead at our trip, to plan the details, to figure it all out. We're going to Walt Disney World. And what it's caused me to do is study. It's caused me to save. It's caused me to work harder at bringing in some extra money so that we can actually afford it. And I'm driving people around me a little crazy, I think, with the amount of joy that I have in building up for this exciting trip. But to actually have a good time there, I'm going to need to actually do some planning. Because did you know that if you want to go to Walt Disney World and you want a good restaurant to eat in, that you have to make your reservation 180 days before you go? because that's when they start booking their reservations. And there's some restaurants I wanted to go to, but they're already booked up. And if you want to actually get a fast pass at Walt Disney World, you actually have to make your reservation for a fast pass if you're staying on property 60 days before, and 30 days before if you're staying off property. And so you actually have to plan. You have to put your mind toward and work towards this holiday. And for some reason, I find that joy-giving. Some of you might not. But could you imagine, as you're sharing this joy, that you want your friends to come with you, and so you invite your friends and you invite people around you to come, and you go on this trip together. That is how God wants us to look at our eternity. He wants us to plan for it. He wants us to look forward to it. He wants us to get excited about it so that we invite our friends to come on the trip and spend eternity with Him. That is how we can have joy in every circumstance, because we're not focused on the circumstance, we're focused on the end. We're focused on God's promise that one day He will call us to be with Him for all eternity. Joy often breeds more joy. Another what if? What if we as a people following God, what if we never stopped praying? Paul wants to encourage us to continually be in prayer, and not just asking God for things, not just God is our big vending machine in the sky and I need something so I'm going to go to Him, but that our lives are lived out as prayer offerings, that we seek Him in everything, that we give praise to Him in everything, that we have prayer on our lips. God is so close to us in our relationship that we're constantly turning to Him. In our own strength, we can't do that. But what if we were people who continually prayed and continually sought after God's best for our lives? Another illustration that I got from someone in our congregation, it was sent to me this a few weeks ago, and it says, "Byron, when I was diagnosed with breast cancer, I had just had my 60th birthday the day before the doctor gave me the news. I considered myself to be very privileged to have had a young doctor who gave me two very important pieces of advice. He said, 'Don't go home and start searching the internet for cancer and all its various outcomes for those diagnoses, because you will inevitably find yourself only dwelling on the worst case scenarios. And if you ever need someone to talk to, you can call me.' Not only," she says, "not only did I have the assurance of God's presence and the church family, but I knew that they were praying for me. And I had a doctor willing to spend time to answer my questions, and one who gave me nothing but encouragement and optimism. I am 9 years now free from cancer. All the tests have come back clean." What if we were people who encouraged? What if we were people who prayed? What if we sought God's heart in our lives? And then what if we developed a foundation of prayer and praise and gratitude? Be thankful in all circumstances. Ephesians 5:20 says, "And give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." Are you thankful this morning? Are you thankful no matter what? Perhaps you've lost your job recently, or a loved one, or maybe you have chronic pain or other health concerns. Such circumstance can be really difficult. But even so, we have so much to be thankful for. We have so much to be thankful for. I want you to look with me at a story that Billy Graham wrote of a man who had every right to be bitter but wasn't. The next footsteps in the corridor, he knew, might be those of the guards taking him away to his execution. His only bed was the hard, cold stone floor of the dank, cramped prison cell. Not an hour passed when he was free from the constraints and the irritation of the chains and the pain of the iron manacles cutting into his wrists and his legs. Separated from friends, unjustly accused, brutally treated. If ever a person had a right to complain, it was this man, languishing, almost forgotten in a harsh prison. But instead of complaints, his lips rang with words of praise and thanksgiving. This man was the Apostle Paul, a man who learned the meaning of true thanksgiving, even in the midst of great adversity, while he was imprisoned in Rome. These are some of the words that he wrote. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord. Always give thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Think of it. What if we always were giving thanks for everything, no matter what the circumstances? Thanksgiving for the Apostle Paul was not just a one day a year thing, celebration. It was a daily reliving, a daily reality that changed his life and made him a joyful person in every situation. Thanking God in the midst of trials and even persecution can happen when we have a foundation forming theology that is built on an attitude of gratitude within our lives. In the midst of trials, we can thank God because we know that He has promised to be with us and He will help us. And we know that He can use this time or these times of suffering to draw us nearer to Himself. James 1, 2-3 says, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know the testing of your faith develops perseverance. I don't know what your troubles are that you're facing, but God does. And I want to assure you that He loves you and He is with you. And through the Holy Spirit, He will work in your heart and your life to comfort you and to cultivate a spirit of thankfulness, even in the midst of your struggles, your trials, and your heartaches. God has given us the greatest gift of all. It is His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who came and died on a cross and rose again so that we could know Him personally and spend eternity with Him in heaven. So what if you stopped building your foundation for your life on the shifting sand and built your foundation of your life on obedience to the Almighty God? Let us pray. Father God, I thank You that we can come into this place, that we can study Your Word, that we have this privilege in our country to be able to study Your Word daily. And Father, I pray that we would not take that for granted. Father, I don't know where each person is here in this place today, and that's why I thank You that You are the great I Am. Because You know our hearts, You know our weaknesses, You know our pains, You know our struggles. And so, Father, I pray that You would meet us where we are at, that we wouldn't focus on the past, but we would set our eyes and our hope on the future, that we would set our eyes and our hope on the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that You will forgive us if we come to You. And Father, I pray that as we go forward, that we would seek obedience from this point forward. And that we would learn from Your Word. And we would build our foundation on the bedrock of who You are and that you would transform us into the likeness of the Lord Jesus Christ. In your name I pray, amen.